All right. Well, hello, everybody. So happy to see you here today. So I guess what we're going to do is, if you have a question, just unmute your mic and say, excuse me, or something, you know, and say who you are. And just feel free to, as usual, interrupt at any time. Okay? So.
Yes, awesome.
I see this is, I can't see all of you, but I'm assuming that this is what most of you are doing these days. So this is going to be kind of a informal presentation since I still don't know what I'm doing here, but it's going to be about some ideas I've been thinking about since I got here to SFI, having to do with formation of concepts in both natural and artificial systems. So probably most of you are familiar with this famous document, which was the proposal for the Dartmouth Summer Research Project on AI, written in 1955 by McCarthy et al, who proposed that they wanted to create a machines that could use language, form abstractions and concepts, solve kinds of problems now reserved for humans, and improve themselves. And there's been some progress on all of these topics, but it's all of them are still, you know, however many years later, big open questions in AI, especially the form abstractions and concepts part. So that's what I'm going to try and address today and tell you a little bit about what people have been trying to do and like what it all means. So I don't know if everybody here is familiar with deep neural networks. I'm sure you've all seen them a little bit. But the main idea is that if you take sort of the 1950s view of the visual system promoted by Hubel and Wiesel, the visual cortex consists of a series of layers like this V1, V2, V4, et cetera. And light propagates through the eye, up through the brain, through these layers, and at each layer, you get features being extracted from the visual scene, like edges, and then that feeds into simple shapes, complex shapes, and et cetera. And that's really the essence of how these deep neural networks work. This is a convolutional neural network, and you can see there's at one end, there's a picture, then there's all these layers at which these different kinds of features can be extracted. And at the end, there's a probability distribution over some set of concepts. Okay, so that's, I'm not gonna say too much about how deep networks work. You can ask me anything you want about it, but I may be able to answer some of it. But as you know, they've done really well on a lot of topics like object recognition, where this is like the ImageNet object recognition challenge. Over the years, this is the error rate, and you can see it's going down, down, down as deep neural networks get deeper and deeper. And this human performance it's really based on a single human graduate student who actually went through some of ImageNet and tested himself. This has led to, you know, headlines like computers are now better than humans at recognizing and sorting images, or AI can caption images as well as humans, read documents and answer questions, etc. Self-driving cars from 2020 will become, well, obviously that's not true anymore. But, you know, we've all seen these kinds of headlines, but what's not clear is what these machines are actually learning. It's hard to interrogate them and figure out what concepts, if any, they have learned. And so when people actually try to probe the networks, like this is a paper that came out a couple years ago where a group took an image, an object that a network was able to recognize with, here, 99% confidence, and then they photoshopped it into different poses, and the network was extremely sure now that it was a school bus, a fireboat, and a bobsled. So somehow the networks are not learning to see in these images what we humans learn to see. This is also true for these image captioning networks. You've probably seen Google and other groups have produced captioning networks which learn from pairs of images and captions and can then produce very human-like sentences about images. But then if you start giving them other images, they come up with some very weird captions, like here a woman holding a teddy bear in front of a mirror, a horse is standing in the middle of the road. Like, okay, where's the horse? You know, and so these networks are learning some statistical correlations that allow them to make good captions sometimes, and so semi-plausible captions other times, but they're not learning the kinds of concepts that we humans understand. And this is true also in game playing. For example, you may recall that Google DeepMind trained neural networks to play Atari video games. This one, Breakout, where you hit a ball with a paddle, you move this paddle, which is this red rectangle down at the bottom, and the ball takes out these bricks. And the DeepMind system learned just by watching the video game and playing to do, you know, more than 10 times better than humans.
What I really want to know is where they found all the code for these fantastic old Atari video games.
Yeah, I can tell you about that later. That's a cool thing.
Melanie, quick question.
Yeah.
Are those things below that horizontal line? Are those games in which it could not actually reach human level?
Yes.
Okay, interesting.
But later work, I mean, this is a little bit out of date. Later work, there's been a lot of examples where, you know, most of these go above the human level line.
Is that all? To get them above the human, is that always because people get in and hand tailor things so it's bespoke for that particular game, or is it in any sense some general purpose technique that's being used to pop things above human?
No, it's a pretty general purpose, you know, deep Q learning technique, okay, as they call it. And there's some like tricks that they use to improve the systems, but it's just like a huge amount of self-play, if you will.
Yeah.
Okay. But again, if you try and probe what these things have learned, it seems that they're not learning the kind of concepts we think they should have learned. Like, here's an experiment where a group tried training a deep Q learning system on standard Breakout and then tested it on a system, on a version of Breakout where the paddles moved up a couple pixels. And now it completely cannot play the game. Even so, it hasn't really learned the kinds of concepts we humans see here, like paddle, ball, brick, because we could take what we learned on this version and easily adapt to playing this version, but the deep Q learning systems aren't able to do that.
Question, Melanie, does it even learn faster than, right. So does its training process go a little bit faster given training on the first board, or not even that?
That's a good question. I'm not sure about that, but it can't do like zero shot transfer. So it may be able to learn faster, but it doesn't seem to be learning sort of what we might call concepts. So, and you know, this problem is also, this kind of problem is also seen in self-driving cars, which learn about all kinds of visual categories, but they then can't, they keep mistaking things as possible obstacles. And so they slam on the brakes and people rear end them.
Yeah. Melanie. So humans do this a lot as well. So there's a literature on tasks that humans perform terribly at when you make slight perturbations, mm-hmm, particularly with motor system. So very well-known example is when you reverse the polarity of the handlebars on a bike.
Ah, okay.
You learn how to ride a bike, and I just now make left go right. You can't learn it.
Okay.
It takes you months.
Right.
So it seems to me you should have, as a control, comparable experiments with humans where we mess up in really silly ways, like illusions, visual illusions full of this kind of thing.
Sure. So we absolutely, and that's gonna, that's a really interesting question is, you know, what is it that we are biased to be able to learn and transfer really well? And what are we bad at versus these machines? But they seem to be bad at things that we are good at, which actually can be worrisome for trusting them to do the right thing in these autonomous situations. And all of you, I think, have seen these adversarial examples where you can take an image like this school bus that's perfectly recognized by a deep neural network. You can manufacture some noisy looking pixels to add to that image. This is actually highly magnified. It's very, very small amount of noise. The resulting image looks exactly the same to us, but now the network is extremely confident that this is an ostrich. And you can target this noise so that the network will classify the resulting image that looks just like the same to a human. It will classify it as any category you want that the network has.
Hey, Melanie, one other question. On the breakout example, and you know, maybe I'm just being your straight man here, but it seems like this depends a lot on the representation which is handed to the network, right?
Yes.
My representation of the screen is this pixel red or not? That's one thing. If I had some low-level representations like, is the paddle below the ball, for instance?
Exactly. So that's the issue. So in the old days of AI, the way we would have programmed a machine to play breakout would be to, you know, give it a representation that included the word paddle, the word ball, the word brick, you know, and we would have it would be given the objects, essentially. And it turns out that kind of trying to program in the representations can produce a lot of brittleness. The system won't be able to adapt then very well. It will still do fine on that particular game, but also won't be able to transfer its knowledge. So that was a problem of symbolic AI. But so that's one of the motivations for going to neural networks and having the system learn end to end how to do the sort of its own representation. But the problem is it often doesn't learn the representation that we think it should learn. So this is a problem with all approaches to AI. Okay, so I guess so what I think the issue is that these AI systems are learning these perceptual categories. They're not learning concepts. So what's the difference? You know, well, for instance, think about the concept of a bridge. So a neural network, if you showed it a whole bunch of pictures of bridges, it would learn probably some features by which it could label them as bridges, or, you know, it'd have a high probability of that. But we humans are able to, we have a much richer representation, as Chris says. So we can say things like, this thing, which is evidently in the Netherlands, it's a water bridge where there's a highway that goes over this lake or whatever it is. And this is a bridge over the highway made of water that boats can go through. So we can recognize that as a kind of bridge, even though the features, the visual perceptual features are quite different. We can also recognize this as a bridge. We're kind of abstracting the concept a little bit, but this is the same general idea. Or we can say we can bridge our hands, the bridge of your nose, the bridge of a song. You know, we have all these concepts that we can extend in this way, abstract way, to many, many domains. We can talk about bridging the gender gap. We can talk about bridging ceremonies from one level of Girl Scouts to another. Joe Biden told us that he's the bridge to the new generation of leaders. Just a couple days ago, he mentioned that. You know, and there's just endless, you kind of go crazy with these, any word like this, you know, we humans are able, our concept of it is much richer. We're able to make analogies. And Hofstadter, my former PhD advisor, so it's not surprising I'm quoting him, defined a concept as a package of analogies, which I really like, because it's that idea that we're taking these very disparate domains and seeing these abstract similarities between them. Okay? So the question is, how can we get machines to learn concepts rather than perceptual categories and make analogies? And this is something, you know, as I showed you, people have been struggling with in AI for its entire history, and it was a fundamental thing in the initial Dartmouth proposal. And I would say very little progress has been made on it. So this is something that I wanted to think about here at SFI, thinking about concepts from both a natural intelligence, that, i.e., you know, human or biological intelligence, and artificial intelligence. So I started reading a lot of papers. I'm just going to tell you a little bit about some of the papers I've looked at and some of the questions I have, and hope to little brainstorm a little bit with you. Okay, so if you were all out there in the audience and I could see you, I would say, how many people have heard of Bongard problems? But you're not. So I'll assume you haven't heard of them. Mikhail Bongard was a Russian computer scientist back, and in the 60s, he wrote a book on pattern recognition in Russian. It got translated into English in 1970. It was really a proposal for kind of a neural network approach to pattern recognition, but in the appendix, he posed a challenge of 100 problems, visual problems, that Hofstadter popularized in his book, Gödel, Escher, Bach. And the problems look like this. Okay, so look at this problem, problem number two. There's six boxes on the left and six boxes on the right. And the task is to determine what the concept is that is being sort of distinguished here. So here, you know, the concept is large versus small, right? And here, white versus black. And there's, you know, the fact that this is a triangle is not relevant. The fact that this is small or large is not relevant here. And then here, you know, vertical, horizontal, here, right versus left. Okay, so those are just a few examples. But let me show you some a little bit more interesting ones. Okay, so what's, anyone who wants to unmute themselves, what's the answer here? I'll call on you, Chris Moore. What's the difference here?
The things on the left have a kind of narrow isthmus or waist to them.
Okay, a waist, good. So that's kind of an analogy, right? You're, I mean, this is a little bit hard to articulate what's going on here, because we don't really have a good sort of geometric name for this. So you call it a waist or a neck or something like that. So we're making an analogy here, but it's kind of a concept we recognize on the fly.
I think it's usually called a pinch.
A pitch?
Pinch.
Pinch, yeah, a pinch.
Yeah, technically, it's a pinch.
Right. Now, what about this one? Anybody?
Horizontal versus vertical pinch.
Vertical versus horizontal pinch, right. So now we can sort of take that same concept and we can recognize it across all of these different, really quite different figures, right? This one's a little easier, you know, same versus different. This one, you know, these are very clever little problems. A lot of them are easy for us, but would be hard for computers.
A question?
Yeah.
Has anyone tried a just binary classifier on this?
Is that Tanmoy?
Yes.
Hi, Tanmoy. Has anyone tried a binary classifier? Yes. Yeah, I mean, yeah, binary classifiers do not work well on this.
I mean, is that simply because the sample size is too small or?
Yeah, I mean, look, we have 6 training examples from each class. That's all you get.
Yeah, no, I understand. I'm just saying that if we had a much larger example, would a standard classifier work? I mean, will it?
So
we can easily take these things and make examples by basically saying we have a generator where we know the concept, because as a human, I know the concept. Supposing I actually just tell it to generate lots and lots of examples of the concept and just train a binary classifier, will it learn it? I mean, I'm trying to distinguish between the possibility that these things are intrinsically hard or from the concept that most of our deep learning things, the general classifiers, need a large amount of data anyway. So I'm just trying to get that big difference.
That's a great question. I'm actually going to, let's come back to that. I mean, my guess is that these problems are varied enough that you would not be able to have a single classifier that could be trained even on, like, you know, 1,000 examples on each side and get it for some of them. But let's come to that, because I'm going to actually talk a little bit about that. Okay, this one's a little bit more abstract. Anybody see what that is?
3 versus 4.
Yeah, 3 versus 4. And then we have, like, you know, triangle versus quadrilateral, even though we have to ignore the background. So Bongard problems are there's 100 of them. You know, you can find them online and look at them. They're really a very clever kind of challenge for AI. Now, you can also change the types of answers. You can say, like, well, here, I'll give you a new figure. Tell me which side it goes on, right or left. We were doing sort of a language description, or I could ask you to generate a new example in each class. And it may be that these different types of answers require sort of different levels of understanding.
Melanie, did Bongard himself, because it's quite clear looking at them that there are some that are just simple cardinality type things, some feel very embodied, like Lakoff in out kind of idea. Did Bongard himself provide a taxonomy of his own problems?
No, he just presented the 100 problems. Okay, so there's been some attempts at building machines to solve these problems. This was one from 2018. And I'll just tell you very briefly what they did. They, as Chris pointed out, it's important to have the right representation. So they started with some primitives and they said, okay, we're going to assume we have some primitives, like we know what circles, rectangles, and triangles are. At least our vision system can identify them, and we can compute different things like the position, size, orientation of objects, so on, and know some relationships. And assuming that, they've developed this context-free grammar, which they're going to use to build sort of little logical descriptions of the Bongard problem, sort of to give the, to express the answer. And I, you know, it's a little bit, this would go into, I'm not gonna go into too much detail, but you can kind of see these are the features that they're assuming the system has. So the system extracts all these various features, and then it says, given all the features that we're seeing, what's a night, what's the right expression, like here, to let's construct an expression from our grammar to solve the problem. And if you look here, the top description for the left is there exists triangles. Okay, it has a few other descriptions, because what it does is it's going to search through the space of possible expressions using a Bayesian inference framework and find, assign a probability to each expression that it decides is semi-reasonable. Like there exists, there's one triangle, you know. And here we have, I actually don't know how to interpret some of these, but you know, here we have contains triangles, like on this side, circles containing a triangle, or contains circles. And so what, if any of you are familiar with this new idea people have proposed called probabilistic programming, it's where you have a set of primitives and kind of a grammar that you can use to produce a program or a logical description like this. And you then assign some kind of prior assumptions, like we like smaller expressions, or we like expressions that repeat things in them, because we want it to be modular. And then you can use a kind of sampling technique based on those priors, and then assign a posterior probability depending on how well it fits what you're looking at. So this is something that's been proposed by a lot of people and used, for instance, by Josh Tenenbaum at MIT, this idea of probabilistic programming for concept induction. And so that's what they do, and they can't, their grammar can't deal with everything. Oh, and I should say, they then do this huge search. They allow themselves 300,000 samples of these rules per problem, where each one of these lines is a rule, okay? And they excluded problems that don't deal with like circles, triangles, and rectangles, or have occlusions. So they were able to deal with 39 of the 100 problems, and they solved 35 of them, okay?
Question. Isn't there some recent work where basically this kind of grammatical sentences are the output of a deep neural network coming from the field of interpretable deep networks? Where basically the deep network, instead of giving the classification, is giving the rule for the classification?
There might be. I don't know that work. I've seen a lot of work on explainable deep neural networks. This particular thing did not use a deep neural network.
Yeah, but I mean, it sounds exact. I mean, it's the Bayesian version of that, because I heard this thing at a recent talk where they were coming up with this, where basically they had a similar thing. They had a fixed set of a grammar for a set of sentences, and the deep neural networks idea was to produce a sentence in that language, and it was evaluated by just checking how well the sentence actually worked as a classifier.
Yeah, so that's similar, right? Yeah, so that's interesting. But the problem is,
it seems to me that this type of approach is extremely brittle. Like if I took, you know, once I developed all the rules, if I took all the pictures and then took a little notch out of every single thing, would these rules just completely fail because nothing's a triangle anymore if I add a little notch?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it depends on the their triangle detector.
Right. But I mean, the thing is that, you know, technically, like if you add just a little notch to a triangle, it's no longer a triangle. So it seems like everything goes out the window.
Right. But I think that, the computer vision system they're using might be able to deal with that and say, yeah, that's almost a triangle. It's a little noisy, but it's a I'll call it a triangle.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's the issue is like, it seems like this is like brittle, like a glass when you want something that's more ductile, like a metal. And
okay. Well, that's, yeah. So that's, there you go with your analogies.
When you say it can deal with 39, does that mean that for 39 of the problems, there's arguably a solution that can be written in this language?
Yes, exactly. So even with the ones
can that- I ask a question briefly? Just, this seems a very long way from questions of concept, which is how what you started the talk out about. I mean, the concept of bridge is so coarse-grained and so systemic and so broad, and it doesn't come to us by this detailed, you know, whatever it was, 3,000, 30,000, 100,000 rules and things. That's obviously not the way we work. So presumably, you know, one wants to have something that is much more holistic and integrative rather than this. If you're going to get to what you started out your talk about.
What do you mean by holistic and integrated?
Well, you gave all these wonderful pictures of bridges, including things that sort of don't look like bridges, but we all got it. No one challenged you. They didn't, like, we all got it immediately. I mean, yep. There wasn't, and my brain did not go through all this, you know, multiplicative processes trying to figure out, is this a bridge or not? By deconstructing every piece of it and so forth.
How do you know what your brain did?
Sorry?
How do you know what your brain did?
I don't know, but it's a question. So I'm wondering how this relates to your bigger question, because it seems not related.
Well, okay, so my bigger question is, how do we get machines to learn concepts like bridge? Okay, one way that's been proposed is, well, let's try and idealize the problem of concept induction. And the idealization is these Bongard problems. You know, they're not as complex as the real world, but they require some abstraction and so on. And then I'm sort of saying, presenting this paper, you know, it's kind of a straw person paper because I don't agree with this method. But this is kind of the state of the art in today's AI.
Mary, this kind of Jeffrey raises an interesting question. I mean, in the sense that if you think about tasks like speed, accuracy, trade-off problems, mental rotation problems. So if I give you an object and I show it in different configurations, I say is it the same object or a different object, they actually take a long time, and you can predict how long it will take. Mm-hmm. Metaphor problems, like the bridge, are very strange, right? Because it seems to have almost zero latency. And I'm just wondering, do you think there's a difference between the way we compute sort of like a standard, I don't know, like a mental rotation task versus the bridge example, which seemed instantaneous? I didn't have to think in the way I feel I have to think about mental rotation.
Yeah, I don't know. It's a good question. I mean, people talk about system one and system two, you know, Kahneman kind of thing. They talk about pre-attentive versus attentive processing, pop out versus sequential processing. You know, I all of these things might be relevant. I don't think they're all cut and dried like that. Mm-hmm. And it may be that, you know, if you've the more expert you are at the more practice you've done on mental rotation, maybe you could do it instantly. I don't know. But yeah, it's a good question. I don't know the answer. So anyway, one more question. Yeah.
Just following up on this question about analogies being instantaneous, are there any experiments which basically takes analogy from one culture, which don't exist in another culture, and trying to see whether it translates without latency, or in, do you get latency in that situation?
Not that I know of. That would be interesting. I haven't looked at cross-cultural analogies at all. But yeah, that's an interesting question. Okay, so anyway, this thing, a big problem is it goes back to the kind of good old-fashioned AI idea where you have to build in a lot of primitives and it requires a lot of search. It's not clear that it can scale to more complex problems. It might be brittle, as Sid mentioned. So this is kind of the why deep neural network people really want end-to-end learning. They don't want to have all this built-in stuff. So recently there's been kind of a controversy about these same different problems, which was one of the Bongard problems I showed you. So there was a paper, this was a paper from 2018 that I won't try to explain the title, but learning same different relations strains feedforward neural networks. Okay, so here's the idea. Oh, this was another, and this was a follow-up paper, testing deep neural networks on the same different task. That was from last year. So here's the same different task. I give you, here's two training examples for you from class one and from class two. And you can see that in class one, the pictures have, all the pictures have two shapes. In class one, the shapes are different. In class two, the shapes are the same. Okay? Seems like if I give you a new picture, you would be able to tell me if it's in class one or class two. And it seems like, you know, one of these deep neural networks that can beat any human at Go or translate between languages or do all these fancy things should be able to do this silly little task, right? So, or you could make it a little harder and say, like, are there two couples of two shapes? So here, here in class one, yes, there's like two couples of the same shape. Here there's not. Okay, so people have been working on it. There's a data set that people use where these can be generated, these different pictures, and you can train it on a huge number of examples. So if you train on 400,000 examples and test on 100,000 new examples and ask what class is it, all right, humans, on average have an accuracy of, you know, in the 90% range. I think this is like testing humans on Amazon Mechanical Turk workers. But then these neural nets, these famous deep neural networks, these are different neural networks, only are getting chance, okay? They can't do they can't do it, even after 400,000 training examples. So that was the first paper that said, you know, these same different networks are strained, these problems strain these networks. But then later someone said, well, why don't we just make the networks bigger and use a slightly different architecture called a residual neural network, which is a ResNet, okay? Those are the, and now you get the networks being able to do the problem, okay? So the question is, what are these machines learning? There's a little bit of difference between the ResNets and these other networks, but they're essentially the same. These are just like bigger networks. And it's very unclear if they've actually solved the same different problem. In fact, you know, if you give them now red ones instead of black ones, they might not be able to do it. But to actually go in and probe what the machines are learning is very difficult. Because often people have shown that on these giant data sets, there's sometimes statistical correlations that allow the system to solve the problem, but don't, I mean, at least do well on the data set, but not learn the concept. Okay. So,
can I ask a question related to that?
Yeah.
Why use a fixed data set at all? Why not just use a generator? I mean, somebody built a generator anyway, because those things were a bit random. So why, I mean, I guess this is maybe a question about the culture of machine learning, but why do people provide a data set as opposed to a generator to challenge each other?
Good question. I mean, I don't, maybe I can't remember if they tried that or not, just generating 400,000 new ones. I'm not even sure how kind of expressive this generator is. Like, can it really make 400,000 different things?
And of course, a generator could have subtle statistical correlations as well. I mean, I'm not sure how I would make lots and lots of quote unquote truly random examples where the only difference between these and those is that these are the same and those are different. I mean, how do you choose positions and orientations and make sure they don't overlap? It's not clear.
Yeah, right. So you have to look really closely at how the generator is working, which is a good lead-in for the next set of experiments people are looking at. So this has become this.
Mike Price here. Can I comment?
Yeah, please.
Presumably, they're actually doing what Chris is suggesting, because I'm almost certain that's an out-of-sample prediction.
Right. What he's saying is, right, it's certainly an out-of-sample prediction. They have a training set and a testing set. But I think what he's saying is, here we have training set, 400,000 examples. Why not train on 400,000 different examples and see what happens?
Why not do 200,000? Because that's effectively what they're doing, is they're adding beyond what would have been a 200,000 sample.
Sure.
I don't think that this is different from what Chris is suggesting. It's just that it's a finite set of generated samples.
Comment? I think that what is interesting in all of this discussion, starting with Chris's comment, is that if I take a fixed set of 400,000 and a fixed set of 100,000 for testing, the fixed set of 100,000 and fixed set of 400,000 in general will have a very correlation beyond what a generator is going to do. Okay, so what is happening is that if I'm taking that fixed set of 400,000 and training by cross-validation, doing whatever I want, what will happen is that if I am testing on the same 400,000, testing on the same 100,000, it might be actually using this, what I should say, fake correlation between finite samples. So the idea is, if the test is always done, if you just keep on testing on more and more stuff, okay, you will probably minimize that effect. That everyone who runs it, every time you run it, you get a different thing. So, I mean, it's probably a small effect when you are talking about sizes like 400,000 and 100,000. But the question is, why not just do it in terms of the generator with a different random seed each time than with a fixed input set?
Yeah, I don't think I'm not convinced it would make that much of a difference.
No, one of the standard reasons that people do this is so that's apples to apples. If you're actually having to regenerate a random set each time, then you've got more noise in whatever you're trying to do. More generally, there is the risk that if you have a fixed, it's not even the training set, if you've got a fixed test set, then you can overcross validate. You can just keep running algorithms until you get one that ignores the training data entirely and just fits the test data, and you're perfect and you're done.
Yeah.
So it's a trade-off of, you want to reduce the noise when people are comparing different papers, different sets of experiments, by using just one training set. But if the community were to get particularly interested, so there's many, many people comparing papers, then you have a multiple test problem, and then you've got to do something like what Chris is talking about. But I don't think it's any more mysterious than that.
Okay, let me move on. So Raven's progressive matrices, this has somehow become really popular recently. because of a project from Google DeepMind. So I don't know if people know about these. This is like a kind of IQ test where here's the idea. You have eight figures here, and there's some kind of progression like along the rows or along the columns. And you have to fill in which of these candidate answers down at the bottom goes in here. So this is, you know, I remember my kids had to take an IQ test in school using this. It was super annoying. I find it super annoying. Maybe that's just because I don't, my IQ isn't high, but but you can probably see that the answer here is like we have, you know, what we have these different sets of these different two figures in each kind of position. And here, and they have, there's a different possibility of vertical, horizontal or diagonal, and then there's a possibility of diamond, square, triangle, and then there's like solid, white, lined, and then you can sort of see, well, it has to be we were missing this one, right? Number five. Okay, so this has long been an IQ test for humans. People like to use it because it's not verbal, so it doesn't require verbal skills. And this is another kind of thing where you can count, you know, 4, 2, 3 filled. I think there's something here to do with size and so on, where the right answer is, I think, 3. But anyway, so now people in AI have discovered this because, you know, psychologists say, well, being able to do well on Raven's progressive matrices is highly correlated with human intelligence, however you want to measure that. So I'm not going to argue about like IQ tests. That's another entire subject, which well, we could get into for hours, maybe some other time. But the question is this a good data set? Is this a good way to study machine intelligence to see how well machines can do on these things? So of course, group put out a data set that they could, with a generator, where their generator basically has, this is a little bit of a complicated diagram, but I just want to give you the flavor of it. There's a stochastic image grammar, which means that they have these primitives like, we're going to have an inside-outside structure, and that inside-outside structure has an inside component and an outside component, and that each component has, maybe it has a 2x2 grid layout, or maybe it has, you know, it's the outside component has a center layout. I just got a message. My internet connection is unstable. Can you all hear me?
We can still hear you. Please continue.
All right. That's scary. Let's see. And then, you know, you have these different things you can stick into the color, size, et cetera. So you can generate any number of these Raven's problems using this stochastic grammar. And so this is a second group, a paper just from February of this year, where they used that generator and they tried a bunch of different methods, but the weirdest method of all, for me, was just a deep neural network. Okay, and here's what you do. So each of these problems, you recall, has 16 images. So the 8 that are in the problem matrix, and then the 8 that are in the candidate answer set. So what they do is they take a very deep neural network. This is just showing, it's much deeper than this, but this is just to illustrate. We have those 16 images that are the input, like this stack of them is the input. Then it goes through the layers. And at the end, you get a probability distribution over 1 through 8, where each 1 through 8 index the possible answers. And your answer is the one that has the highest probability. Okay. And what this group found, and then you just do, you know, you do a ton of training, 42,000 training examples, that is, these generated problems, 14,000 test examples. And this is just a bunch of different methods. 12, this, just look at this, this column, the very first column. This is the accuracy over of each model over all of its test examples. 12, you know, 1/8 is 12%. So that would be the that would be random guessing. And their deep neural network, especially this ResNet 50, which is a 50, more than 50 layer neural network that has been pre-trained on the ImageNet data set, is able to do extremely well, better than humans. Here's the human performance. Okay. And so a few thoughts, and then you give me your thoughts too, but then I want to move on to the last example. So it seemed really weird to me that you would take this approach, right? That you would train extensively on these problems where the test is really meant to indicate more general abilities. The test is kind of a placeholder. The test is a stand-in for general abilities. And here they're training to the test. And they said the reason they're using this generator is that even though there's all these IQ tests out there, the collections of these Raven's matrices used to test humans aren't well suited for machine learning since the amount of available examples is not usually sufficient. Okay. So to me, that's in one way, it's like defeating the purpose. For the purpose is to say, to use this test to see if you have these general abilities.
As a Melanie, I just want to point out, no, I agree with you. Just, I wish people know, there's something called the Flynn effect, which you know, right, which is this increase in IQ over generations. And most of that comes from Raven. It's very, very trainable IQ. Mm-hmm. They're like crossword puzzles. Humans get good at them by doing them.
Right. Now, the question is, but humans, I think, are actually doing them in the way that, you know, we think they should be.
I don't know, actually. I think the data suggests that they're not very good tests of generalized intelligence when you once you get a bit nerdy about them.
Okay.
It seems like you just, there, it's a trick, right? You just notice, oh, you know, in each row has one of each of three things and find whichever one is missing. And it's just a trick. It's one thing
it's the same game as set, if you've ever played set. Our machine's any good at set. I am interested to know if anyone's done any like teach a computer to play set kind of thing, and how about the approach is.
I don't know the answer to that one. Someone does, but I think the problem. Okay, so there's two questions. Well, there's the question of whether this test tests anything at all that's useful. And then there's the question of like, what are the networks actually learning? Are they actually learning to apply the rules that we would apply? Or are they learning some weird statistical, you know, patterns that are irrelevant to, that just, are they kind of reverse engineering the generator? And why does it require so many training examples to do well?
Mike Price here. Are you implying that humans aren't doing that, that we're doing something that's categorically different than statistical learning? I don't disagree if you believe that. I just want to clarify.
It depends what you mean by statistical learning. I would say that forming concepts, as I said, is different than just statistical learning. But I guess it would take a while to kind of unpack what that means. Let me just talk about the last thing. which I've been reading about. So this fellow, Francois Cholet, who's at Google, and he's a deep learning person. He's invented the Keras platform, if you've used that. Anyway, he recently wrote a paper about measuring intelligence. And he basically said, it's all BS to be able to have a generator and sample unlimited training data. He said, you know, the benchmark, we should avoid tasks like that. It shouldn't be possible to practice, but that's, you know, what we should be aiming for. And his idea, you know, that he thinks these generator problems are just, you know, we can reverse engineer the generative with enough like deep layers, it's possible to reverse engineer the generative program. So instead he defined, okay, let me just come to his tasks. He recently defined a new set of tasks that are sort of reminiscent of Bongard problems and sort of reminiscent of the letter string analogies that I used to work on. So here's his task. The training examples look like this. There's a grid, you have colors, you have basically just some number of grid squares that have different colors. And you take that initial pattern and you create this new pattern. Take this initial pattern, create this new pattern, initial pattern, new pattern. Now, I've shown you three demonstrations. Do the same thing to this test. So, you know, here he's saying like, okay, take the colors are changing horizontally. So let's just show the three colors horizontally. They're changing vertically, et cetera. So you can kind of get the idea. And he sort of manually created, I think something like 600 of these little grid problems. So the idea, here's the initial, here's the final, here, initial, final, initial, create the final. And he has a whole bunch of these. You can download a little demo of this. But you generally get the idea of how these work. So here's one where it's like, the blue is in front of the green, the blue goes behind the green, right? Okay, so there's a training set, what he calls a training set of 400 tasks. So one of these things is called a task. And so he offers everybody, offers the world 400 of these. He keeps secret 600 that he made. And this is now a Kaggle challenge. You could make $20,000 if you solve this. So in case you've just like lost your entire retirement account, this might be a good way to go. Except you only have 3 months. There's a kind of a weird evaluation. You're allowed three guesses. So like for this problem, I'm allowed three guesses for the final grid, okay? And if you get one of them right, you get a point, and then your error score is like over 600, 1/600 times the number you get right where you got three guesses to get it right. And the leaderboard right now, I don't know exactly how these people are doing it. So lower is better. One means you've missed everything. So the best is 0.9 now. So it's not doing great.
Wait a second. That 0.9 looks pretty good for a computer. I mean, about 10% of the time it's getting, about 10% of the time, one of its three guesses is exactly the desired grid, right?
Yes. Yeah. Okay, well, maybe
that's actually better than I would have expected.
Yeah, maybe. So the question is So his statement is this could be used to measure a human-like form of general fluid intelligence, enables fair intelligence comparisons between AI systems and humans. Is this really, so I guess, you know, and then I have this whole thing, which I don't really have time to show you about, with this work I did on letter string analogies, which are sort of similar, which I did back in the 90s with Hofstadter, letter string analogies like this. And I think some of you have seen these, where the idea is you can, it's very similar to the Cholet thing, where you have some initial pattern, some final pattern, then you make the, you have a test now. I only have one example, but I want you to do the same thing to the test that you did to the initial, to find the top row. And you can just go, you know, here's a picture of one of Hofstadter's notebooks pages, because we came up with, you know, thousands of these problems, just like Cholet came up with about 1,000 of his problems. And I wrote a program to solve these. I'm not going to go into that. It can't solve all of them, but it can solve some of them. And let me come to just my questions, since I'm over time, unfortunately. If we want to address this whole problem of getting machines to learn concepts, should we be looking at these idealized benchmarks like this? And if we do, how do we evaluate the results? How do we make sure that the results on the benchmarks will teach us something about real world concepts? And these are the kind of questions I'm grappling with here in my research and thinking about how to do this right. And I'd be really happy to get your thoughts. And if anybody's interested in collaborating, I'd be thrilled to work with you. And I'll stop there.
I'm going to unmute for the clapping.
Yeah, this is, it's be easy on me. This has been a weird experience.
I actually think it's been great. So we'll continue doing it.
Yes, yeah. Thank you very much for being
here.
Thank you.
Can I make a comment? I mean, are we going to, can we?
Yeah, go for it. Yeah.
Who are you?
So I'm Artemy.
Oh, hi, Artemy.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for the talk, Melanie. I was just going to say that I think this is kind of building on Jeffrey's point a little bit, maybe, but I think the progressive matrices and abstract reasoning task and the letter analogies, in my mind, they all exhibit a sort of computational view of intelligence. And by that, I mean that, you know, in my mind, they all seem to kind of be getting at what is the shortest program for transforming this one thing to another thing.
Yeah.
At least that's how, you know, I think they're very close to these kind of algorithmic information theory or Turing machine type ways of seeing, you know, inference and intelligence. And I think it's a very important and interesting type of intelligence, but I'm not sure it really is at all the same thing as what you were saying with the bridges. And I guess my comment is I'm not even sure it's the same kind of analogy in my, you know, one seems to be more about inferring a very simple rule to that from very few examples. And the other one seems to be maybe mapping a single thing or network of things to many different, very different domains. And sort of seeing very fluid similarities. That's what I was going to say.
Yeah, that's interesting.
If I can, sorry. Yeah, I think the claim that it's about the shortest program is not, that's not clear to me. So what I like, as Melanie knows, I'm a big fan of that paper of hers, as well as of her more recent work. And I think in that paper, she emphasizes that it's not so much, I think in many cases, right, the shortest program to give the answer would just be print the answer, right? What's interesting is that there are analogies that are somehow more convincing, like, you know, saying, well, what's really going on here is, you know, take the last letter and change it to its successor in the alphabet or something, mm-hmm. which probably, depending on your representation, is harder to say than just print out ABD, you know? So there's some sense that there is a more insightful structural thing going on, which is somehow not just about simplicity or program length.
I mean, I think that I was maybe simplifying a little bit. I mean, I think it would be a long discussion, and I don't think printing the, I agree that the actual sort of cost function for the right program is not necessarily as simple as I made it, but it seems like something about basically finding a concise and elegant, whatever kind of desideratum we have for the rule set. So finding a concise and nice set of rules. And I guess I was just saying, it's not clear to me that the bridge thing is the same, is about that also.
By the way, I mean, just printing the, you can't print the right answer if you're talking about multiple different tasks. You've got to be able to say, here is an input, and I'm going to do something to right. that input to make my output. So it's not just print the right answer. There's actually an algorithm, and the algorithms that Melanie described, all of them, they're short, using the precise kinds of representations that you, Chris, were correctly emphasizing.
But many of her tasks consist of one example.
Right? I think there should be a prior, like, give different answers for different inputs.
It is not that there is one example, because look at the task. You are given a lot of problems. It's true that each problem has, let's say, one task. And what you're trying to learn is a concise set of representations. Yeah. Which will help you simultaneously answer all the questions from one examples.
Yeah.
And then what you have to do is to generalize to new problems which are similar. The idea behind all of this is that the reason we are generalizing the concept of a bridge is because we have some idea of bridges which is not captured by just showing you examples of bridges. The reason, for example, the ants look like a bridge is that the bridge has some idea of joining things. And the fact that joining is an important concept comes from a lot of human experience, which has nothing to do with pictures of bridges. So this last thing that Melanie was talking about is actually interesting in that regard. What we do is we show lots of problems which we claim are interesting. And what you are trying to tell the machine to do one way or the other is to figure out what concepts are in, what is the grammar in terms of which you want an answer.
But also I think that the precise reason that Melanie said that she was annoyed by some of those IQ tests points to a fraught danger, which is how do we decide what is right and wrong? How do we decide that we are right in what we say it should be compared to what the computer does? If the computer could go through and find patterns that I, being like Melanie, very annoyed by these, didn't find, in what sense am I right and the computer is wrong?
Absolutely. And the sense in which one is right and one is wrong is whether or not the concepts that you are using are concepts which are important to our daily life.
Yep.
The reason the IQ tests, I mean, without practice, the IQ test correlate to whatever extent it does, intelligence is precisely because it is trying to use primitives which are useful in a lot of problem solving. And that's the only correlation there is. So if we take a proper diverse set of examples to learn from, I think it starts approximating a concept forming task. Of course, the trick is that short of asking the machine to live our lives or some approximation thereof, I mean, forget digital twins kind of thing, short of that, what is a good set of test examples where we can test out all of these ideas?
Yeah, I mean, David earlier pointed out that the Bongard problems have some concepts that like we understand in terms of like our own bodies and our own physical interaction with the 3D world. And I think bridge is another example of that. You know, we understand bridge in terms of our interactions with it. You know, we learn early on that, you know, you cross a bridge and you go from one end to the other, and then we use that kind of metaphor to understand more abstract concepts. So a big question in AI is, you know, can a disembodied machine that doesn't interact with the world except through these kinds of weird inputs, can it ever learn a concept?
The answer must be yes, right? Because at some level, it would be really odd that I can take a concept, as I said, from a culture I have never been in, okay, a particular ritual which has a particular symbolism for them, and I can actually map it on to, I can take two different rituals, and I can say both of these are coming of age ceremony. Mm-hmm. Even when I personally might have not gone through any coming of age ceremony. I'm getting it all through descriptions I read in novels about whatever I know about cultures by talking to people. So if I can do that, if I can generate a concept like coming of age ceremony, I think that it must be possible, at least in some ways, to get these concepts without actually having an embodiment of any kind. So embodiment, I don't think, is necessary for concept formation, because in many cases, we manage to do it. In fact, we manage to form concepts about completely fictional worlds, about fantasy worlds. So I think that is not, in my mind, the real difference between what we are doing to computers and what we are doing here. I think in humans, I think what is happening is that we are actually looking for concepts as the bedrock on which we basically solve a whole set of different problems. A concept which is useful for solving only one problem is probably not interesting to the human. On the other hand, the way we design our computer tests, we let it define a concept for each problem that it is getting. And I think that might be an important difference.
I think you have to be careful, Tamoy, about your remarks of deriving insight from novels and claiming that's not embodied. I mean, you're using the entirety of your experience and familiarity to develop an empathy for that concept. It would just be gobbledygook to you otherwise. So it's not that, I'm not sure that your example refutes the idea.
As I said, if they take the example of coming of age ceremony, you do not know whether or not I went through a coming of age ceremony myself. You do not know whether or not I actually had to take part of it, did play an active role in it. But you, I'm sure, will not claim that if I understand the concept, I must have participated in one.
No, but it gets to your point about primitives. I mean, the elements.
Absolutely.
Elements you've experienced.
I completely agree with you. I was bringing this concept of fantasy worlds in exactly the same way as I was bringing in the concept of these concepts which we haven't participated in. But nevertheless, they are built up. They have this same idea that a concept which is useful, which basically a concept which can never neither be generalized nor be made more specific to apply to a particular problem, a concept at one level of generality, I do not believe is something which is useful. Mm-hmm. And that's what we test computers on these days.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Chris.
I think it's, there is some sort of abstract or symbolic intelligence that humans have that has somehow been abstracted from our physical experiences, although some cultures are much more interested in these sort of nerdy games than others. But, you know, lots of cultures play board games and so on, things that have been, they're physical originally, but they're boiled down to some kind of discrete structure. And then, you know, there's this interesting game in the world of AI of choosing a domain, strings of letters, you know, matrices with colors, whatever. And it seems like the work on ImageNet is a kind of funny, it's almost like an uncanny valley between the two, right? We're asking you to say something which feels very embodied, like what's a bridge, but we're giving you only this very abstract view of it, a bunch of pixels. And it has obvious industrial uses and commercial uses, but it seems like a funny middle ground. But I also wanted to say something about this, we were talking about with algorithms before. So I guess maybe I was confused, but because I think there are sort of two levels of what we meant there. One is when you have a letter string analogy, which is a one-shot thing, like one training, one test, ABC goes to ABD, what does PQR go to? When a human sees that, we immediately play it out into our minds as a huge list of possibilities. That we think that one is drawn. If you showed me that, there would be a short program that worked on all of them. On the other hand, if you only show me the one, then I can give, I think, what Melanie called the sort of village idiot answer, like, oh, change everything to ABD, right?
There's no right answer, right?
Well, but it's clearly unsatisfying. But then there's this higher level thing, which I guess that guy with who was making up these 600 tasks with the color matrices. Mm-hmm. There we're asking for a single algorithm, a sort of meta algorithm, which handles all of these. Something which is like analogous to your copycat program, as opposed to the little description that it's trying to discover. So, yeah, when I was complaining about the program length, it was about those individual, it's like there's a very short program which takes that particular example that's on the screen now and gives the right answer. But thinking of, we see this, we generalize it to many examples, and then imagine a short program which would work on all of them. And that's, yeah. But we have to do that imagination to come up with that.
All right. Well, this has been a great discussion. I appreciate your participation.